Young babies and be in the hospital. So, but be in prayer for the young family, not just because of the wedding today, but Ryan and Mandy, they will likely have another baby this week sometime, I'm guessing. So that's great to see. Today?
Right
after the vows. Yeah. During the vows, there will be a birth as well.
Oh, I pray. I hope. That's why I had a dream last night. Just went everywhere.
I wanted to mention, too, for the regulars here at the church, Renee has taken over secretarial duties from Sydney. We appreciate years being served in that capacity, but we're slowly transitioning over, so she's redoing the bulletin and adding to it each week and stuff. So if anything's a little bit off, let her know. She'll be glad to correct it. But whenever you start the bulletins, you'd be amazed at how easy it is to make mistakes in them. But get with her. But Renee's actually not feeling well today, so she's not here today. But you can check everything out there. If you have any questions, get with me. For those in the grow class after church, well, there's no grow class after church. We're having a meal. So we'll pick up on the 28th probably again with everything going on this month and such. Any other announcements that need mentioned from the floor? That's about it. Well, would you bow with me and let's pray. Lord, this week is really an answer to prayer. We pray for Jessica and Daniel that they get here, and Lord, I appreciate they did it the right way. Lord, we pray as a church body, as friends and family, that the vows that they will confirm again today will lead them into a lifetime of commitment to each other and the development of a godly family, and all the joys that that entails. We also pray, Lord, that you would bless them in the trials that they'll face as man and wife. And Lord, we think of Ryan and Mandy, and they've got a baby that's gonna happen. Someone you've given them. And I don't know, Lord, whether it's a boy or girl yet, but you do. We pray for that child even now, that boy or girl would grow up to be a follower of Jesus Christ, and they would be in the very center of your will. And Lord, we pray that during this birthing, that it would be a very healthy birth, and Mandy would be come through well. We thank you for so many blessings that we have. We can think of a lot of the negative things of life, but Lord, when we think about it, there's an awful lot of many positive things in life. And we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, I want you to stand before we have our call to worship. I want you all to stand up if you would, please. So please stand up there. Now, I want you to turn and look around. Okay? Now, so what you're going to do now is you're going to find someone and say good morning to that you don't know. So let's just have a free fall right now. Go find everyone and say hello. Good morning. Good morning.
I'm going to stick this with you right here. I think we'll have a better view of the wedding, okay? Monitor that, right? Swing it around. Can you do that?
Swing it around?
Well, you know what I'm saying? When they come down.
Well, when they're doing the wedding, I'm going to be doing pictures.
That's what I'm talking
about. Yeah.
That's what you can't do.
I can't do that.
Are we live?
No,
this is Cameron.
saw you. Yeah.
Oh. Yeah, sit down. I just needed to get this area here. Don't touch it, okay?
There's always a danger
when you have to
We have to stop all this fun because we're in danger of becoming Pentecostals. But it is good to have you all here today and such. And like I said, this is a little different from what we're doing today. But you're going to also see some of the stuff we do on a regular basis. And one of them is every week, one of our teens comes and shares a call to worship. And Mark's got it today. So Mark, would you go take it away? Good morning, everyone. Today I'm going to be reading Philippians 13, 4 through 8. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast. It is not proud, it does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. Would you please bow your head for me? Dear gracious God, from love we are made, and to love we shall return. May our love for one another kindle flames of joy and hope. May the light and warmth of your grace inspire us to follow the way to Jesus Christ and serve you in your kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Would you please stand with us again?
And now your reign is still and crowned above.
celebrating the resurrection of our Savior. We stood in awe of a Redeemer who's defeated sin, conquered death, and changed our eternity. Now, the work of the church begins. It's our time to go and tell the world about Jesus. To let them know they're loved. To show them they're cared for. To be the light of Christ to those around us. The story of Easter is not meant to be kept quiet. But this gift is not meant to be kept secret. The love of Jesus, His grace and mercy, the power of His resurrection, are meant to be shared with our friends, with our families, our communities, our nation, and our world. Today, there is light overcoming darkness, hope destroying hopelessness, victory rising out of defeat, and life rising from the ashes. It's time to climb the mountaintops and proclaim in one loud voice, He is risen. He is risen.
Ushers, please come forward.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, just thank you for this day of worship that you've given us. Father, we just ask for your blessing and anointing on this offering that we're about to take, that we would use it wisely to further your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Smarts. Anybody else, including him. I said, smart. I'll let this just said, more intelligent. It's just, I think he just worked.
Offering. It is now the time to release the children to junior worship. All of your children.
You got the baby?
There's a
once-in-a-lifetime eclipse. I love your fur vest, it's so cute. young God of the galaxies, created the galaxies, and every bit of the splendor that we'll see light up the sky and darken the sky, and just be a moment as it'll just seem like the whole world is stopping for a minute and worshiping the God of creation, the God of the galaxies. So we have this song, and if the part you don't know, it's fine just to listen.
I feel like darkness.
See your heart in everything you've made.
sense, so there's something wrong with whoever said that. Actually, I was a little worried because partway through the service, Daniel got up and left, and I was a little worried. So you've already taken the plunge. I was hoping my wife would have junior message today because I saw some one-liners about marriage that I thought I should share. And she always gives me a nasty look, but she's not cooking lunch today, so I can get away with it, but she's not here anyways. Socrates, the great philosopher, said these words: "By all means, marry. If you get a good wife, you'll become happy. If you get a bad one, you'll become a philosopher." Think about that one for a minute. Another one: "One never realizes how different a husband and wife can be until they begin to pack for a trip." Some of you, you've seen that before. The guy throws in a small thing, and the women throw in everything. The wife says, "My darling, this scenery makes me speechless." The husband responded, "Perfect, we're setting up tent here." Some of you got that one. Another one: "Marriage is when a man and a woman become one. The trouble starts when they try to decide which one." Close to home. I personally like this one. That's just why I wanted to run out of the room. Wife says, our new neighbor always kisses his wife when he leaves for work. Why don't you do that?" And the husband responds, "How can I? Don't even know her." I've got a neighbor who's about 90 years old, so that's a little scary idea. Our topic today is, of course, marriage. And we're going to do it in the context of our sermon series on spiritual warfare, because, as I'm going to share with you in a minute, if there's one thing that's being attacked today in our country, it's marriage and family. In spiritual warfare, one of the most powerful ways that the enemy attacks is by devastating and destroying the foundations of society. And this is especially true for the most basic element of any society, the union of a man and woman in holy matrimony. Now, what is kind of sad, and I've got multiple marriage books on my shelves, is most marriage books ignore this idea. Andreas Kostenberger wrote, "Regularly, the focus in marriage books is on fulfilling one's partner's needs in marriage, improving one's communication skills, or resolving marital conflict. From reading any of these books, one would never know that spiritual warfare is a vital issue in marriage and family. Yet, in fact, spiritual warfare is an all-encompassing reality. There are forces that want to destroy your marriage. Not just the political woke stuff we see today, but there are unseen realities that want to destroy your family and your marriage. Kostenberger is right. But we can fight back. We can fight back by filling our minds with what the scripture teaches us about what a marriage is supposed to be. And not just for Daniel and Jessica, but for all of us, some that are married now, and some of us that will be married in the future. The enemy's plan is to destroy marriages and families. And if we look at the Christian worldview, we can see how to confront those false ideas that come out there. One of those false ideas is, and I've seen it all my lifetime, it has really messed up women's lives, is that you can have everything. You can have that CEO job, and you can have the perfect kids, and you can do all those things, and it's perfectly easy. There ain't enough hours in the day to do all that. But those are a lot of ideas, and the same thing for men on different fronts. Struggles in marriages are part and parcel of a fallen world. Whether it's the world, the flesh, or the devil, marriage and family is under assault in America today. We have, in our own country now, there have been bureaucrats and prosecutors that have taken children away from parents in our country because they refuse to let them have gender change surgery in our country. They've been arrested. The child's been taken. So it's much closer than we think. So how do we fight this? Well, we fight it with biblical principles. We respond to error with truth. And that's how we overcome. And that's the way it'll be in every marriage. We we have to respond to the errors that our society throws at us. Our society today says, well, just give up and move on. You can start anew. But the scripture says, no, fight for your marriage. Fight for your spouse. Fight for your children. And that's what we need to do today. When I was a lot younger, the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association, I was influenced by them a lot. And I remember studying some principles by them. And I think these principles are especially good because many couples go into marriage with little preparation. And sometimes they lack the emotional maturity or stability or the flexibility that is successful for people to have in a union called marriage. And what I'm going to share with you today is something we must always work at. You never arrive in marriage. There's always you can be better at these things. And so I challenge you today, not just those that are reaffirming their vows, but for all of us. And I would challenge those of you that will be married today, Frankie. Pray for his future wife. Frankie is my favorite punching bag at services. I like him right there. He's my favorite. I owe Frankie a lot of gratitude, though, because every time I would visit Brian's shop, Frankie knew where the ho-hos were at, the pop, everything, and he would always get them for me to Brian's chagrin. Don't worry, you won't be in trouble for that. He can't do anything about it today. What are the foundational components for marriage? Number one, mutual respect. Respect is very important in a marriage. Respect is especially key for women to give to their husbands to keep the marriage protected. I know we say today that, well, love is the most important, but love is expressed in different ways. And for the man, and we know this psychologically from about every study, the man needs to know his wife respects him. Now, the wife needs respect too, but the wife needs more of the love than the respect. Those are just psychological facts. We all need love, and we all need respect, but women tend to need more of that love side, and men need to see that love sort of shown in respect. There are large parts of our society where there are deadbeat dads, as we say, or there are fathers who just don't care. And we ask ourselves, why does that happen? Well, there are various reasons. But it's interesting, in our country, when they study why fathers have nothing to do with their kids, and I'm not talking about the ones who would like to, because there are some that, when a divorce happens, things just happen, and it's tough. But there are some who just don't want to. And I lived in Youngstown, and there was an 80% absentee father rate in Youngstown at the time I was there. And they did a study, and they found out that one of the reasons why these men would leave is they just felt no one respected them anymore. And that's not an excuse to not take care of your kids, but the fact is, it's a reality. It is really important for wives to understand you have to respect your husbands. And it's really important for husbands to love their wives. Paul knew this thousands of years ago in Ephesians 5:33. Let each of you love his wife as himself. So he defines how you should love your wife. Love your wife as you would yourself. And let the wife see that she respects her husband. Isn't that interesting? What we're just learning in the 21st century, Paul knew 2,000 years ago. Let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. Mutual respect is important. One writer notes that respect means that each partner accepts the other partner as he or she is, not trying to manipulate, but unselfishly nourishing the partner in such a way that he or she may become the person God intended. You see, respect helps people to become what they're meant to be. When I was a soldier, and some of you were sailors and Marines and all these other different areas, but the drill sergeants would teach you how to be a soldier, because we're all soldiers in the end. He would teach you how to be a soldier, sailor, Marine, airman, whatever. But one of the things he was trying to teach you is to have respect for who you are and to carry that respect out. Because drill sergeants didn't see you as you are. They saw you how they wanted you to become, which was, in this case, they were soldiers and they were Marines. Now, if you struggle with this in your marriage, there's a print-off in the notes, and I know we couldn't find our bulletins because Renee's ill today, and she had them in the filing cabinet. We didn't know where it was at, but there's a book called Love and Respect, and it's in the notes if you see me afterwards, but there's a picture of the cover. It's a wonderful book to help you if you're struggling with that in your marriage. Number two, genuine commitment. In all marriages, there is a requirement to forsake all others. It's scriptural, 19:5 in Matthew. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. The oneness is supposed to be so close that it's like one person. And that is alien to our culture today because we talk about our rights. I remember this one young man when he got married. He was like shocked at his responsibilities after he got married. And he said, well, I can't do this, and I can't have this, and I can't have this. And I said, yeah. And he thought I was going to support him. And I says, the moment you said I do, your desires became secondary. And third, and fourth, and fifth. And then you had children, and that adds to it. You see, for the husband, marriage is about sacrifice. That's what genuine commitment is for a husband. It's sacrificing for his family. Now, it might not be what Hollywood likes to promote, but it's what the scripture promotes. This one-flesh concept does not mean that you become less, however, but that together you become more than you are alone. We have a saying in our society that there are many great men, and behind this great man is a woman who made him or helped him become great. I remember when George Bush Jr., not senior, but junior, when they were interviewing him, he made it abundantly clear that he would not be president and he would not have been governors and all those things if it wasn't for the wife beside him. He just would not have done it. In fact, he implied that he would have probably been an alcoholic. And that's why that saying exists. You look at some of the greatest men in history that we say, look at that person. And there were women behind them that helped them become great. The fact is, in a biblical marriage, the personality of each person and their personal rights are heightened and not lessened when it's biblical. Number three, good communication. One of the things that people today do not understand because of the woke culture that we live in is that genuine communication must include understanding of the emotional, mental, and physical differences between men and women. Now, it is obvious if you're married that men and women are different. Right, Ryan? Very different, right? How many husbands have said, is there anything wrong? And your wife says, nothing. She's lying. You know very well there's something. But they all say it, don't they? I don't want to get you upset because I want to get through the service. It's true, though. Every husband, is there something wrong? No. You know there is. And I can tell you it's your fault. Whether it's your fault, it's your fault. Just accept it. That's good communication. Men and women are different down to the very chromosomal nature. We know that scientifically now. Men and women are biologically down to their chromosomes different. And I might add, you can't change it. You can't change it. You have to understand this in communication. For all you single guys, I've just taught you a major rule in marriage. Mark, listen. When you ask her, is everything okay? Is there something wrong? And she says no, there's something wrong and you're at fault. Okay? That's life. Now, if the wife asks the guy if there's something wrong, he just tells her. Usually, there are exceptions. And then she ignores it. That's great. My wife's not in here. I can do whatever I say. I can say whatever I want. Something else, though. Communication doesn't just discuss differences that we have, but also a meaningful exchange of intellectual and emotional needs. I have been amazed over the years that I have found when people get married, even though they're very different from each other, that the intellectual and emotional needs of each person complements each other in a marriage. And sometimes they don't really match. I can tell you, when we were in junior high, my wife couldn't stand me. And she's so polite. But I'm not joking. We had weird classes. She could not stand me. But then, you know, things changed. Began to see behind the walls. She's probably right. But suddenly there was a big change. And over the years, I've been amazed at how my weaknesses are her strengths and her weaknesses, I have a strength. And that's the way God's designed it. And you become one. You can ask her for a rebuttal later. Furthermore, this communication will need an understanding of companionship, which essentially means our spouse is the person we want to be with more than anyone else. Your spouse should be your best friend. I remember on TV a guy talking about how his best friend was another woman, and his wife was his wife. And I just said, man, you're an idiot. I just thought, you're going to suffer immensely. He actually thought he could have a girlfriend and hang out with her and have a wife. Yeah, that's Forrest Gump stupid. I mean, that's really dumb. And I've seen the same with women saying the same thing today. I can tell you something. That just don't work. I remember one woman, this was about 10 years ago, she actually said, a former boyfriend, she was still friends with, and they would have lunch or something together. And I said, have you talked to your husband about that? What's he feel? And guess what? He didn't like it. His wife was having lunch with a former boyfriend. He didn't like that. How silly of him. Amazing. Number four, time and effort. Time and effort means quantitative and qualitative. It's got to be good stuff, and sometimes it's lengthy stuff. You know, I was watching a comedian talk about going to Disney World. I've never been to Disney World. But he says, you stand for an hour and a half to go on a two-minute ride. He said, that's love. It is. He said, it's horrible. For the father, he says, when I grew up, I never understood how in the car Dad was always mad on vacations. And he said, now that I take my kids on vacations, I know why he's mad. He said, because you spend hours doing nothing, standing in line for a two-minute ride, and you go through it every year. Time and effort. Furthermore, the love you have at the beginning of marriage will not be the same love later on, because love matures over time. It becomes deeper. It gets over the difficult things. The problem today in our society is people like to call it quits too soon. And they need to fight it out and work it out and make it work. There's also a sense in which marriage has struggles, and you don't quit when those struggles arise. You don't look at marriage as a bad bargain, but you make it work. Interesting study was done on the world. They studied marriages of people, and they found that the most contented marriages, marriages that are working and people are contented, were arranged marriages. Think about that. Can you imagine if your mom and dad decided on who you marry? That seems alien to Americans, doesn't it? But they found they're actually happier. Now that's strange, because they know going into that marriage, some of them don't even see who their partner is until the moment they get married. Can you imagine? Flip the veil up and it's like, oh, you know. Can you imagine that? Yet they found in study after study that they're more content. Strange. We have to remember something. Malachi 2:16 says this. The man who hates and divorces his wife, says the Lord God of Israel, does violence to the one he should protect, says the Lord Almighty. So be on your guard and do not be unfaithful. Now I know we live in a culture. I know there's people in this room, no doubt, that have been through divorce. I'm not here to beat you up. But I'm here to say from this point on, as you think about marriage, remember, God holds those who commit. You notice how he says when you divorce your wife or your husband for no reason, no legitimate reason, in this case it's the man, he says you do violence to the person you should protect. The husband is to protect his wife. And I was so glad in that one shooting, it was a terrible shooting, but I was so glad to see that so many men in a recent shooting in Florida, that was probably 2 years ago, that they they literally threw themselves in front of the shooter and protected all the women at the particular restaurant and took the shots and died. That's what men are supposed to do. Take time to work it out and endure the culture of our day about what they say about relationships, because the relationships of the culture of our day are often shared or talked about in the wrong way. Ephesians 4:32 notes, be kind to one another, compassionate, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ has forgiven you. It's so important to clean the slate each day and night. You should never go to bed angry with your wife or your husband. Ephesians 4:26. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. How many of us have violated Ephesians 4:26? Deal with it quickly. And finally, number 5, spiritual unity. We must understand that the spiritual aspects in a marriage are really important. In fact, they often define everything else. One of the important things to understand in a Christian worldview of marriage is that it's not just a man and a woman. It's Daniel, it's Jessica, and it's God on top, deciding on what's right and wrong. And the goal of a marriage is both the husband and wife are to move on. Imagine there's a triangle. I think it's in your notes. But there's a triangle. There's Daniel, Jessica, and God. And both of them are moving closer to God. And as they move closer to God, they're also moving closer to each other. That's the biblical way it's supposed to be done. The union of a husband and wife is so important that Paul even describes a metaphor for it. He says that Christ and the church are that kind of oneness as well. That's how important it is. Ephesians 5:22 and 2:33. Billy Graham once said, the perfect marriage is the uniting of three persons, a man, a woman, and God. That is what makes marriages holy. Faith in Christ is the most important of all principles in the building of a happy marriage and a happy home, and a happy home, and I think he's right. I was glad to hear Daniel mention that God's the first place on the triangle. I don't understand Jessica's language, so I didn't get her rebuttal there either, but I'm sure she agrees. A home without spiritual oneness is a home in conflict. And this is one reason why the Lord does not want us to be unequally yoked. So, what do we do as we close out this part of the service? What do we do if things aren't going well in our marriage? Does anyone have a perfect marriage where there's never been an argument? Anyone? I would let Kathy respond, but we'd like to be home by 4. In all my years of, I've been doing this for like 30 years, I guess. I had one couple say we never fight, but all of us that knew them said we don't know what you mean by fight because, man, you guys can be ruthless. I remember they would just go at it and they said, that's not fighting, it's disgusting. I said, well, it might not have been punches, but it was close. So what do we do when there are struggles? Number one, discover the reasons why these components are not happening. The 5 things I've just mentioned, ask why they're not happening. What responsibility do you have for the issues? Are you able to forgive? If you ain't able to forgive, don't get married. Because you got to forgive a lot. And what do you need to repent of? It's not just enough to say, hey, I'm sorry I didn't do this. And then to keep doing it over and over again. You got to repent of it. You don't do it anymore. Number 2, does God have first place in your life and the life of your marriage? Is he the final authority? If you're not getting along, what do? You go to the Word of God and says, oh, yeah, I'm wrong. I shouldn't have done that. God says that's not what I should do as a husband, or that's not what I should do as a wife. And then he decides. That's how it works. We don't like that, though, sometimes. We don't like to be told what to do, but we should. We should. Get into the Word to find out how your marriage should be designed. Figure out your role in the marriage. And I know, once again, in today's world, men and women having roles, oh, that's a terrible thing to say. But I can tell you something. It works. Because God made us, and he knows what our role should be. Number 3, pray for each other and get involved in worship ministry in a small group within our church or your church. Be actively involved together in a biblical church. in every study I've ever looked at, and there's been some recent ones, have shown that people who are faithful and regular in church have better marriages. And a lot of the secular groups that do these studies, they're like shocked. How can that be? Even in churches where they say the husband is to be the head of the home, to lead the home, to sacrifice the home, even those marriages are shown to be happier and more successful. Supporting your spouse's work in ministry and witnessing will pay off. God doesn't just save us. He saves us to serve. To serve each other and to serve those outside the family. Number four, seek counsel if troubles continue. And remember this. If your marriage gets into trouble, seeking counsel is not a sign of weakness, it's a sign of strength, because you know you need help. If you have a broken arm, do you go and look online and say, let's see, how do I solve this? No, you go to a doctor. You get help. If you got a bad infection, you go to a doctor and get help. If you got a problem in your marriage, go to someone who knows more than you and get help. Sometimes, just find someone who's been married for 50 or 60 years and say, we're having troubles, and sit down with them. And I can tell you, they can save you a lot of money, because they're going to go right to the point and say, man, you're stupid. And you know why they know that? Because they were stupid. Seek counsel. That's a strength. And finally, meditate on Scripture. Passages like 1 Corinthians chapter 7. Verses 3 and 4, and Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 through 5, and 1 Peter 3, 7. Reflect on Scripture. It is amazing how, if we let the Scripture, we just think about it for a while, how it speaks to us and guides us. When we let these principles into our life, and when we realize these principles aren't happy in our marriages, when we do some of the things I've just mentioned, we can solve a lot of the breakup of families in our lives. So I challenge you today, as husbands and wives who are already married, to reflect on these things. And some of you are relatively new in your marriages. There's a couple newbies there. We're going to all go through difficult times. You're not all going to have a perfect husband like my wife has. I just want to see if you're still listening. I just want to make sure you're still listening. I think I heard her say an expletive out there. Today we're gonna take some vows. And I want to challenge you husbands and wives out there, whether you're new or whether you're old, I want to challenge you to listen to the words and recommit yourselves. In fact, I'm gonna challenge you during the vows to take hold of their spouse's hands and sort of together by holding hands, recommit yourself. Make sure you grab the right woman. You'd be embarrassed. There is marriage counseling today at 4, by the way. We're going to sing a song. I'm going to ask Brian, I think you're going to be in the back of the sanctuary, to bring the guy out. So go ahead and head back there. And we're going to sing a song together as a congregation. And then Kathy's going to sing a song, Catherine Without an E.
I'm singing.
Catherine Without an E.
I'm Catherine, not Catherine.
What is it?
She's Catherine. I'm Kathy.
Catherine.
You don't
want to
do it.
Betty here is going to sing, gonna sing a song. Yeah, with the good hair. And they're going to come down the aisle. But I really want to challenge you today. We live in a difficult world. A world that fights against our enemies. Recommit yourselves today. Recommit yourselves today. Would you please stand up? Thank you. kids to find their families. If there's kids you don't want, just hide.
So are we supposed to go up there?
Yeah, you stand up front.
What side?
That side up.
As I said earlier, we're gonna daughter-in-law's gonna sing a song. What's the name of the song?
Love Remains.
Love Remains, which sounds good for a marriage song. And before we do that, then Jessica's gonna go by our crew and such. But once again, it's great to have you here. And I appreciate you coming and hope you stay for the whole meal. We have come together in the presence of God to confirm the marriage of Daniel and Jessica. We have prayed for several months at this day. We've come, and now it's here, and we're awfully glad to have you here in the United States and such, along with Mackie and a couple in the oven. So we're looking forward to seeing them as well and such, but we're glad of all this stuff. For some of us in the church that might not know, they were actually married in Mexico, but of course, to be in the United States, that marriage wasn't recognized. So we're going to do it today in order to meet both the Christian concept, but also the civil responsibilities of marriage in our nation. So that's what this is about today and such. And appreciate everyone that's helped out with today. I'd like to pray for the couple right now, so would you bow with me as we pray for them? Father, as we think about Daniel and Jessica, we pray that they be in the very center of your will, that each would fulfill the roles that you've given to them, and that you would bless them and help them to apply some of those truths that I talked about earlier in the sermon. Lord, help them to allow you to be the superintendent of their marriage, that you would watch over them, and that you'd watch over the children, and the children to be, once again, two gifts that you've given to them that are going to be here in July. And we pray, Lord, for their health. As witnesses, Lord, help us to be there for them. If there's a need they have in their lives throughout the years to come, as witnesses, we are agreeing today to be there for them and to help them and to guide them and to be there for them when they get in difficult times. Lord, we thank you for them. We thank you for their extended family. And Lord, we thank you for the many, many blessings that we have in marriage, all because of you. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to share just a couple of basic concepts about marriage. The institution of marriage was first set forth by God in the Garden of Eden, of course. God created Adam perfect in every way and placed him in the perfect environment. Yet, even in a perfect environment, he placed within Adam a need, and that need was for companionship and for fellowship. Even in paradise, man had a need, and it was for a woman and such. God himself said it was not good for man to be alone, and then he created Eve to meet that need. When I was at Asbury learning some of the biblical languages, suffering, I should say, through learning the biblical languages because it was difficult, I remember in Hebrew, the way we would pronounce that part of Genesis when Adam sees Eve for the first time, in modern vernacular, he says, wow. That's the best translation for modern vernacular. Adam sees this woman and says, wow. He'd seen all the animals, he'd seen the monkeys, elephants, and they were great, but then he sees someone he can have fellowship with, and he says, wow. That's what it's supposed to be. In Genesis, Eve was a helpmate, a partner in the ministry of life. And they went through some pretty difficult times together, but they made it through. The scriptures go on to say that God brought Eve to the man. In other words, God took the initiative in meeting Adam's needs. God is going to meet the needs, and already is, of Daniel and Jessica and vice versa. That's the way it's supposed to be. God took the initiative. It's clear from the biblical account that God ordained marriage for a lifelong companionship of a man and woman. That means Jessica has to put up with Daniel for the rest of his life. She's smiling on that one. That's what it's meant to be. And have you ever noticed, if you've ever seen a couple that's been married for 60, 70 years, how sometimes they even look alike and they act alike? That's what's supposed to happen. There comes a point where a husband looks at his wife and knows he's in trouble and she hasn't even made a look. She just looks and he knows I'm in trouble. That's because you get to know each other so well, you know everything. Genesis 2:24. For this cause a man shall leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. The concept behind that is, if you've ever done woodworking before, sometimes when a board breaks, You have to glue it together. And what's amazing about it is when you glue it together, it's actually stronger at that place than in the rest of the board. And the concept behind the language here is like a board being glued together. And it's stronger together than when it was broken apart. And that's what he wants for both of you, to have marriage that's stronger together. Daniel and Jessica, because you both have received Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, the covenant relationship that you are now entering into is not only a covenant that you are making with each other, but also a covenant with our Master Jesus Christ, for he is the one who will sustain and bless your life together. Now we have something called the declaring of intentions. And I'm going to share with Daniel these right now, and then Carlos is going to help me because it's a little bit lengthy with translating this for Jessica, just so we make sure everything's clear. Daniel, the scriptures instruct you to love and lead your wife unconditionally, just as Christ unconditionally loves and leads his church. The Apostle Paul writes, husbands, love your wives as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her. Husbands also ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church. Daniel, will you confirm Jessica to be your wife, to live together with her as your companion for life? Will you love her and lead her as God has instructed? Will you give yourself to her and for her? Will you pray for her, and will you forsake all others, being faithful to her, faithful unto her, until God shall separate you by death? If so, please answer, I will. And I'm going to share with you in English what I'm going to ask Jessica, and then Carlos is going to translate it. Jessica, the scriptures teach that wives are to honor and respect their husbands, just as the church honors and respects Christ. Again, Paul writes, wives, be subject to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is also the head of the church, he himself being the Savior of the body. But as the church is subject to Christ, so also the wives ought to be subject to their husbands in everything. Jessica, will you receive Danny to be your husband, to live together with him as your companion for life? Will you honor, respect, and love him as God has instructed? Will you give yourself for him and to him? Will you pray for him? And will you forsake all others, being faithful to him until God separates you by death? And here, Carlos, is what I have asked you to translate. He said, Jessica, will you say, I will? That's good. I was worried there for a minute. I'll need you with the rest of this a little bit. As I said earlier, if you're sitting next to your spouse, I want to encourage you to think about the vows that we're going to affirm today, and I want you to reaffirm it with your spouse today, if you're with her today. We'll start with Danny's vow first. I, Danny, take you, Jessica, to be my wife. You got to hold hands now. Look into his eyes and make him comfortable. To have and to hold from this day forward. For better or for worse. For richer or for poorer. In sickness and in health. To love and to cherish. Until we are pardoned by death. And would you share Jessica's vow, please? Yeah, you can say it in Spanish if you want. Seems longer in Spanish, doesn't it? I've got two rings here. They, of course, are symbols. Every covenant has a sign or symbol to remind each partner of the responsibilities he or she has to the covenant relationship. These rings are symbols of your love. These rings are visible reminders to you and all others that what you have promised you will do. Wear them as a constant reminder that you are pledged together and committed to one another by life. And we'll start with Daniel. Please take the small ring there, place it on the wedding finger of your bride, and repeat after me. This ring I give to you as a symbol of my love. And I pledge to you my loyalty and devotion until we are separated by death. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And now, Jessica, would you please read that to her? The kind of love and commitment that Christ desires you to model to the world is demonstrated in 1 Corinthians 13. Love is patient, love is kind, is not jealous, love does not brag, is not arrogant, does not act unbecomingly, does not seek its own, is not provoked, does not take into account the long-suffering, does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth, bears all things, believes all things, and hopes all things, and endures all things. Love never fails. Would you bow for me one more time? Lord, I pray that you once again would bless this union. And Lord, we thank you for the coming together of two families. We thank you, Lord, for the children on the way. We thank you for the fellowship and the meal we're about to receive. Thank you for the many, many blessings that we have. And a big one today is standing right in front of us. Thank you, in Jesus' name. Amen. You want to get married too? For as much as you, Daniel and Jessica, have openly pledged yourselves to one another in love and faithfulness, in the presence of God and before these witnesses, and having confirmed the same by each giving and receiving a ring, and by joining hands, I, as a minister of the gospel of Christ, confirm you as husband and wife. What therefore God has joined together, let man not put asunder. You may kiss your bride. Well, we're going to have them stand right over here. And there's food and stuff going to be served in there. So you can congratulate them as we walk into the hall. And once again, great to have you here.
Okay, so they just got married a second time in the United States, and Daniel's friends are here, and we appreciate everybody watching. Thank you so much for your support. Again, you know what's funny about this whole store and everything is turned into kind of like a family, and we appreciate you watching, and thank you for all that you've done. We'll let you see people here for a while, saying hi to Jessica. I'll just leave this here for a little bit.
Sorry.
Thank you.
Well, guys, wow. I'm not Professor Tinker. I'm the Professor Tinker. Road trip.
Spider-Man?
Yeah. We'll just put this camera in here. I'm going to set it up over here. Right here on the steps so you guys can see it. And this is the food that we're gonna have. And we'll keep this on for a while. You guys don't have to obviously see, but I appreciate it.
Thank you. Not quite there yet.
You ready for some food? Just ignore me. Just turn right around. Okay. I see how you operate.
Wedding couple! Hey, where's the wedding?
They're getting pictures.
Yeah, they're still up there.
Are you ready then?
I think we can. Oh, they're getting happy.
You can come and get food now. Just get in line and grab it.
Is it my food? That wasn't waiting for you, Brian.
No, just come and get it.
My kid's hungry.
Come back. There that you. It's in the middle. Dealer's choice now.
That's good.
Where's your plate?
I'm not looking. I don't think it'll be.
Like,
Hey, Mom, did you get hot dogs?
No, you told me not to get hot dogs.
You gonna be good here for a little bit? I'm gonna
call you back.
That is criminal.
Right over there, okay? Here, my God. I didn't want to bring my come back up here. You're Yeah, super. I'm not going to put any extra thing on this yet.
Yeah, I've waited for it.
On the park. We don't have no hot. Are you serious?
I'm
Hey, Brenda. Do you want them? Brenda. Well, that's my nephew, and that's his son. What would he be? That's my nephew.
How old would he be?
That's his son. What would he be? I'm a great uncle.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, man. You're going to want to be in it all the time.
Yeah, she's the crazy one. Lord, it's not funny. Yeah, she's the crazy one. Hey Jackson, how you doing, buddy? Working on that fire. Great on you. He's got a great idea for it. Carter, how you doing, buddy? Man, you look just like Frankie 5 years ago. Frankie is well. Oh, 14. He's 13. So you work for the city? You work for the city of Oregon?
No.
I heard some last night.
I'm going to Get ready, we're gonna go soon.
I'm just looking at the comments.
She just
I
right, guys, thanks for joining. Yeah, Adam looks like he didn't. Yeah, thanks so much, guys. Thanks for joining. I'm going to shut this down.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that. That's on.
All right, guys. Thanks so much for joining us. Glad you could join us for our wedding.
Oh, my gosh. I forgot that was on.